We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward is our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing the islands of the sea. Echo back the ocean caves. Earth shall keep her jubilee. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. In salvation full and free. Highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
And then back to hymn number 107. Is Lord, I lift your name on high. Let's sing that chorus together.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save.
Beautiful singing this morning. Let's pray together. Pastor Pete, please lead us.
Let's pray. Father, we have gathered today as the body of Christ in this place to lift your name on high. We're so thankful that we can do that today, that we have the freedom in this country to be able to gather freely, to be able to proclaim your name without threat of violence. And Father, we're thankful for all the many blessings that you provided for us, especially that of salvation, how Christ came to this earth, lived a perfect life, and died in our place upon our cross, paying the penalty for our sins. But I thank you that the story does not end there, and that though he paid that penalty full and completely, he then rose again, giving us victory over death and hell and the grave, so that we bear no pain in death. We bear no fear in death. But that Christ is our salvation, our great hope. And as he rose, we too will rise. So bless us and encourage us today. May we rejoice in our great Christ today. We pray this in the name of Christ. Amen.
Please be seated.
your name, the mountain shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name.
Praise the name of the Lord today. It's the name above every name, the name at which one day every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's stand together. We're going to sing a beautiful chorus. We do have Brother David Alger and his wife Brenda with us this morning. They're going to be presenting with about the missions of the Gideons. And so I thought this would be an appropriate chorus as we prepare for our offering. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Let's sing it together. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still You're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and the light unto my path. Amen.
It was a wonderful word to be able to hold on to and to be able to read and study, and we're thankful for God's word. As we prepare for our offering today, I have a couple letters one from Phyllis Smith, thanking all of our card members, our card senders especially. She appreciates those and is thankful for that. And then I have one from Lowell Griffin, thanking you for the wonderful gift that we gave to his family while they were here. So that is wonderful. And then as we go to prayer this morning, be remembering the Don O'Regan and his family. Don's dad went home to glory this past week. Be praying especially for the family as opportunity to present the gospel is given. It was Don's request that the family would hear the gospel and respond to that. So let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we are so thankful to be able to give back to you just a portion of what you've given to us, to give you our tithes and our offerings as an opportunity to bless those around us, to bless the church, to bless our missionaries, to bless as you have blessed us. Encourage us today. Be with Don and his family as they are preparing to go to Oklahoma, to Iowa in a little bit to be with their family to as they mourn the loss of a loved one. I pray that you would encourage them and be able to present the gospel clearly, Lord, so that your kingdom would be advanced there. Father, we ask that you would be with us, bless us, and encourage us. Praise in Christ's name. Amen.
I was waiting for Mary to play the offertory, and I forgot I told her to cut it today because we have a lot going on. So please forgive me. Well, anyways, every April of the year, our missions team put together some powerful videos that display our missionaries that we support, and it allows us to get to know them a little better. And it allows us to pray for them a little more intelligently. So let's watch one of those videos right now.
Hey, man, who's that cat coming down the street?
I don't know, but it sounds to me like that whipping man with the bone.
Sure having himself a ball. Thank you.
Thank you, missions team, for putting that together. It's something about that song makes you want to spin a basketball, doesn't it? But just as this world is spinning like a basketball, we have globetrotters that go all across the world representing Temple Baptist Church, presenting the gospel to the lost. David, do you want to introduce the video, or is...
It's a video about Tempe Brown.
Okay. Yeah, so we have a video from the Gideons, one of our great local ministries. Let's play that video.
I was raised in the church. I knew about Jesus. Well, I know about Prince William, too. I don't know him. There's a big difference between knowing about somebody and knowing them, isn't there? I got married right out of high school. It was a bad marriage. We had three children. It ended in 1968. I left Florida, went back to my hometown of Oklahoma City, started looking for work. I found a job illustrating children's reading books, bringing home $65 a week. And of course, that wasn't going to make enough, so I had to work a second job. And I always thought I could sing, but I wasn't sure I could do it professionally, but starvation will give you a lot of courage. So I auditioned, and much to my shock, they hired me. And so there I was, Oklahoma City's new jazz queen. And so I was working two jobs, and it's kind of hard to raise a family when you're never there. I was never home. And my girls began to get in trouble. And it just went on, and it was bad. I sent my son, Tommy, back to his dad, who'd remarried down in Florida, thinking it would just be a short amount of time till I got those girls straightened out. Well, they didn't get straightened out. They went to prison, both of them. And it was a hard time for all of us. Well, some time went by. They got out and kind of went their own separate ways, and by then I had put a show band together, and I looked just like Cher in those days, can you dig it? And I hit the road with my band. My two brothers got very sick about that time. My oldest brother, Don, was a dentist in Birmingham, Alabama, and he got multiple sclerosis. And my brother, Jim, was a plant manager with Union Carbide, and he got leukemia. And instead of becoming bitter, both of them turned their lives over to Jesus Christ. And they started praying for me. Guess you know what that does. Put me on the holy hit list. And as I traveled, I literally lived in hotel rooms and motel rooms, sometimes 2 and 3 weeks at a time. Guess what's in all those hotel rooms? Bibles, placed by the Gideons. Thank God for you, Gideons. And when you're looking for answers, you'll pick those things up. And I was definitely looking for answers, and so I began to pick them up. And of course, we all know the Bible's the only book in the world where every time you open it, the author shows up. And he showed up. Can you imagine the Holy Spirit on the road with a rock band? He was there. Aren't you glad he doesn't care who he hangs out with? Thank God. And so I would open it up, and he'd show up, and he would minister to my heart through the Word of God. quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And that word began to work in my heart. And I read a scripture in John 3, just below John 3:16, where it said, men love the darkness because their deeds are evil. And that scared me, because for the first time in my life, I realized I was in darkness. And I did not have that light I had been reading about. And that scared me. And that put me on my knees in a Holiday Inn in Owensboro, Kentucky, crying my eyes out. And I asked the Lord to forgive me of all my sins and to come into my heart. And he wasted no time at all. He'd been waiting for that prayer for 38 years. And I got up off my knees, a brand new little baby Christian, didn't have a clue as to what to do next. So I did what I always did, went right back down on the stage. And I got down there and I looked around, and first thing I said was, how come it's so dark in here? It wasn't any darker than it had always been. It's just that the light of the world had moved in. And when he crawls up from behind your eyes and he's looking around, nothing looks the same ever again. And the second thing I noticed, and this is kind of weird, I loved everybody in the room. I thought, what am I supposed to do with this? I thought, well, maybe a loving thing would be to tell them what I'd learned, which wasn't much, it was more they knew. So I started telling everybody in the nightclub about Jesus. And that went over like a screen door in a submarine, I'll tell you right now. They really didn't want to hear it. Isn't that funny? The thing we need to hear the most is the thing we want to hear the least. But I couldn't help myself, because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And that was big in my heart, so that's what came out of my mouth. Well, that got me fired. And that happened in San Angelo, Texas, in August of 1977. And I left my band, left a message for them not to ever try to find me, not to look me up. And I went out and got in my car and said a little prayer. I said, Lord, I don't know what you want with me, but from this day forward, you have my undivided attention. I sure had his undivided attention on that cross. And I started driving north. I figured I'd hit Oklahoma somewhere. I didn't know where to go, so I started praying about that. And pretty soon, I started getting this kind of homesick feeling for Lawton, Oklahoma, where I graduated from high school in 1957. I'll wait while y'all count it up. I had no reason to go back there. I had not communicated with any of my classmates in 20 years. My parents didn't live there anymore. But I just longed to look up my best friend in high school, Catherine Stanley. So I got there and I looked her up, and she invited me to come over and spend the night. And as I drove over there, I thought, she's going to think I'm crazy. She's going to ask me what I'm doing here. I don't know what I'm doing here. First words out of her mouth, well, what are you doing here? And all I have is the truth, so I started telling her everything that happened to me, and pretty soon she lets out with a great big, well, praise the Lord, like to scare me to death. This is great. I'm going to have all the ladies in the church come over and meet you in the morning. I said, oh, swell. I was not thrilled. I didn't think I had the clothes to meet the ladies in the church. You know that one? Hello? Well, all I had was tight jeans and a t-shirt with something stupid written on it. It was either that or something wild and glittery that I wore on the stage, and I thought, wonder which one I ought to put on. So I found my least tight jeans and my least stupid saying on my t-shirt and brushed out that long black share hair, came walking out scared to death. And I just stopped in the hallway and said a little prayer. I said, oh, Jesus, please let them love me. Little basic need we all have. So I took the big plunge. I stepped into that kitchen, and those ladies turned around and they looked at me, grinning like a bunch of horses eating briars, you know, just. And they just loved me, thank God. If they ever saw that stupid saying on my t-shirt, they were very careful never to let me see their eyes traveling across it. And they came over and put their arms around me and welcomed me into the family of God. And for the first time in my life, I understood what the church was all about. Because Jesus said, they'll know you by your love. And these ladies personified the love of Jesus Christ. And this one lady was so cute, she comes up, I just can't wait to hear you testify. I said, against who? See, my daddy was a judge. I knew what that meant. And they left, and we had a nice time, and I told Kathy, I need to call my kids. And my first prayer after I came to Christ was, Lord, please let me have all my children back. I got my daughter Mindy on the phone, and she invited me to come to Greenville and start my new life with her. And so I went to Greenville, found a job, found a church, began living my new life in front of my child, and I blew it sometimes. I'm backslided, blew it sometimes. Anybody else blown it yet? Wow, what a holy group. I bet y'all just glow in the dark, don't you? Anybody else blown it yet? Yeah, like every day, right? Especially with this. My daughter April came to Greenville, moved in with us, started going to church with us. She gave her heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ. My son came to live with me. He gave his heart to Jesus. And my granddaughter is now in Connecticut with her husband planting a church up there. And all my children, my grandchildren, all because of some busy men called Gideons placing Bibles in motel rooms. Thank you.
How do you follow that? I hate you. I'm going to kill you. That's the mindset of a man that had been wronged. He was going to travel to the town where this man lived, and he was going to kill him. He had a gun. He traveled to that city where the man lived, but he got there really late. So he decided to check into a hotel. He was very agitated and could not sleep. He looked for some reading material, and what he found was a Bible placed by the Gideons. He began to read. You can imagine what housekeeping felt the next morning when they walk into the room and find an open Bible with a fully loaded gun on it. And a note beside it, partly read. The words in this book saved my life and the man I was going to kill. Now that note found its way to Gideon's International in Nashville, Tennessee, and that was shared with the Gideons. Praise the Lord for changed lives. That Bible was purchased by Christian brothers and sisters just like you, and was placed by Gideons like me and the Gideons that are in your audience here with you. The Gideons International is an association of Christian business and professional men and their wives, the auxiliary. And we're truly interdenominational in scope and worldwide in outreach. Our only purpose as an organization is to bring the lost to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we do this by placing Bibles in the traffic lanes of life, and also by witnessing when we get that opportunity. With the help of our Christian brothers and sisters this past year, we were able to place more than 56 million scriptures around the world. Gideon's distributes scriptures in 199 countries around the world and 109 different languages. The relationship that the Gideons have with the church started in 1908. The Gideons had an idea. They were going to place a couple of these Bibles at the desk when someone would check into a hotel, and if they needed them for devotions that evening, they would have them. But a pastor, Reverend E.R. Burkholder, heard about the Gideon's idea, and the Lord placed it on his mind to expand that idea. And at the Ministerial Association of Cedar Rapids, Iowa, he made a resolution that the local churches would purchase the scriptures if the Gideons would place them in every single room in the hotels. From that point on, and since 1910, the Gideons has been a missionary arm of the church. I have another testimony for you. That's my son out there. I've never seen him cry before. That's the beginning of a story of a store owner in El Salvador. The Gideons had a distribution that day at a school, and they were having a morning session and an evening session. And they went to the morning session and distributed the scriptures, and everything went well. So they left, and then it came back in the evening. And when they noticed in the evening was that some of these little scriptures had been torn all up and thrown on the ground. So they didn't like that, but they picked them up and put them in the empty boxes that they had. And they did their evening distribution, and everything went well. And they decided to leave and go toward home. So at the edge of town, they saw a young man sitting on the steps of a store with one page from one of those scriptures that had been torn up in his hand. And he was crying, and he was saying, "Can you tell me about this man I've been reading about, this man named Jesus?" Well, a couple of the Gideons stayed with him and talked to him and told him about the man named Jesus, and a couple of the other Gideons went in the store. The store owner was also crying. He was saying, "That's my son out there. I've never seen him cry before. Can you tell us about this man he's been reading about, this man named Jesus?" That day, both father and son accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. So what somebody meant is mean by tearing up that scripture and throwing that one page ended up in the hand of that young man. But God meant it for good. Praise the Lord for changed lives. And we have it from Isaiah 55:11 that God's word does not return void. Well, you may be interested to know that the Gideons have a new avenue to reach the youth of our nation. This program is facilitated through church youth groups and the youth of churches who can also go to churches from the church and go to the school and hand out these life books, which are based on the Gospel of John or the Gospel of Mark. And they do a peer-to-peer type of distribution. Since we started that program in 2010, over 30 million of these have been distributed to high school children or students by over 2 million students. So that program's available. These are provided free by the Gideons to youth ministers at the churches, and they can give them to their youth, and the youth can go to the schools and do a distribution and do witnessing. So you may be thinking, what can I do to help? Well, there are three things I'll mention this morning that I would recommend you do to help. First, we need your prayers. Prayer is the biggest thing that we need. We need prayer for open doors so that we can do distribution of God's holy word. We need prayers for laborers to hand out the scriptures and place them in the traffic lanes of life. And then we pray for a steady stream of funds so that we can buy scriptures to be placed around the world. Secondly, I would ask you to consider membership. If you're a business or professional man, we would ask you to consider joining us. And also, if you'd like, you can meet me after the service and we can discuss that more. There's also an opportunity to be a friend of the Gideons, which allows you to pray, to also receive prayer requests, and also be able to buy these little scriptures without the emblem on them that you may also give out. And thirdly, I would ask you to continue your support for the Gideons. And you all already do a lot of that. This church is one of the most supportive churches that we have in the Amherst County. You support the Gideons when you use the Bibles. We have these cards in the back, the Gideon Bible cards. When you donate in memory or in honor, you can donate Bibles and send one of those cards. The cards are free. You also give us monthly donations, which is greatly appreciated and allows us to distribute. You support us when you support the Birthday for Jesus, your Temple Christian School, your K-4 and 5 and elementary students. They actually, each year for the last 8 years, they have been donating their pennies and their nickels and their dimes, and they've been allowing us to place hundreds of these small scriptures around the world each year by doing that. And I just want to thank you for that tremendous amount of support that you give us. I thank you for your attention, Pastor and congregation, and thank you for allowing me to be here this morning to give you an update with the Gideons International.
Well, thank you, David. I always love hearing from the Gideons and love those Gideon testimonies. They're always so great and just the simple message of the gospel. I appreciate that. John chapter 10 is where we will be this morning. John chapter 10. We're looking at our good shepherd. I love this passage. John chapter 10. Let me get there myself. We'll look at the first 21 verses. We probably won't cover them all today, so don't worry. But it says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of the strangers." Verse 6, "This parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not what things they were, which he spake unto them." Excuse me. Verse 7, "And then said Jesus unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep, and all that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep." Verse 13, "The hireling fleeth, because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it up. No man taketh from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. Therefore, there was a division, therefore, again among the Jews for these sayings. And many of them said, he hath a devil and is mad. Why hear ye him? And others said, these are not the words of him that hath a devil. Can a devil open the eyes of the blind? Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to examine this chapter, to look at our good shepherd and all that he does for us, especially in regards to salvation. Bless us and encourage us. Allow the Holy Spirit to illumine this passage for us today. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Sheep are wonderful things. They're dumb animals, which is probably why we're equated to sheep. But they're mentioned many, many times in the scriptures. 1 Peter chapter 5 talks about shepherds and sheep. Psalms 79, we are the sheep of God's, the people of his pasture, the sheep of his fold. Psalm 80, Psalm 95, Ezekiel 34 is a whole passage where God talks about the shepherds of Israel and how they are eating the flock rather than tending the flock and what he intends to do to them. Especially verse 22 to 24 talks about how God will come and will gather his sheep and will feed them and tend to them and take care of them. Probably the most famous reference to sheep in scripture is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. How wonderful is that? In this passage, we find is really a carryover from the previous chapter, chapter 9, where Jesus heals the blind man. Remember, we called him Billy, blind Billy, formerly blind Billy, because Jesus heals him. And as such, he heals him, and then Billy goes and he talks to the people around him, and then he talks to the Pharisees, and there's a big debate over what happened, how this man who was born blind is now able to see. And as such, the Pharisees cast him out of the synagogue. And then Jesus comes to him at the end of chapter 9 and says, do you believe on the Son of God? And he says, well, who is that I may believe on him? Jesus says, verse 37, chapter 9, thou hast both seen him, and is he that speak with he? And Billy says, Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. Then Jesus responds, he says, for judgment I am come into this world, that they which see not might see, and they which see might be made blind. Then some of the Pharisees, which were with him, heard these words and said to him, are we blind also? Jesus said unto them, verse 41, if ye were blind, ye should have no sin. But now ye say, we see, therefore your sin remaineth. What we talked about in that is that because they said we can already see, they did not come to Christ to be healed. They would not come to Christ to have their sins forgiven, therefore their sins remained with them. But if they realize, look, we cannot see, we have all the scriptures, but we don't understand them, we cannot do anything to save ourselves, therefore they come to Christ, he heals them spiritually and forgives their sins. He then leads into chapter 10, verse 1. He says, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up another way, the same is a thief and a robber. So he's addressing these Pharisees. And he says, I've got some stark words for you, but also some words of comfort if you will listen. So we see first here the fold. We've got to discuss this passage. And in discussing this passage, we have to understand what a fold is. So I raided Eleanor's stuffed animal pile. And she's got plenty. This one, we're still debating in the household whether it's a bunny or a sheep, a lamb. We're going to say it's a bunny today. It doesn't have the nose of a lamb. The sheepfold was an interesting thing. It was a small, well, semi-small enclosed area. I'm walking. I had the fellas bring these up for us today. So the sheepfold would be a small enclosure whereby, that's no good, whereby the shepherds, as they are out in the fields with their sheep, they would come and they would rest for the night with their sheep. And they would bring their sheep at night into the fold. Looks nothing like this. But if you will, we have an enclosed area. And there, each town that had shepherds would have an enclosed area. Now it would be a lot taller and a lot bigger. But I'm out of space up here, so we'll go with this. And he would bring the sheep in each night. In fact, all the shepherds would bring their sheep in each night, and they would mill about in there, and they would close the door, and they would even go hire a porter, a guardsman, a doorkeeper. And that man would be there all night long watching the sheep. I missed. In the sheepfold. Those sheep would be there, and they'd be safe. In fact, they would even have them outside of towns occasionally, where if they would go out for a multi-day trip to pasture their sheep further away and they wouldn't be able to come home for the night, they would have stone enclosures that they would bed the sheep in for the night. This was the sheepfold. Notice first off under the fold the differences in entrances. There was only one entrance to the sheepfold. That's through the door. That'd be right here. And the porter would be there, and he would not let anybody in except the shepherd. That's why it says, "To the shepherd comes in by the door, to him the porter openeth." But notice what the thief does. The thief, he doesn't bother with the door. He says, "I'm going to come in over the wall." So he comes in. It's not this easy on a real sheep pen, sheepfold. But he climbs, he scales the wall, and enters inappropriately. So we see there's the door, the proper entrance. But there's also the thief who climbs in over the wall. I'm not a thief, even though I'm jumping over, okay? The thief climbs over the wall, and the shepherd enters by the door. We see the differences of the entrances. We see, be here, the declaring to the elect. The declaring to the elect. We see that in verse 3. It says, "To him, to the shepherd, to him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leadeth them out." There are four things in this verse that we can see. We see first the authority to enter. The authority to enter. It says, "To him the porter hath opened." He comes up after a nice night of rest at home with the family and hopefully able to wash up and stop smelling like sheep for once. But he comes back and he goes to the porter and says, "Hey, I'm coming back for my sheep." The porter says, "Okay, yeah, yeah, I recognize you. You dropped your sheep off yesterday." So he opens that door and allows the shepherd in. It is the authority to enter. To him, the porter opened. Secondly, we see the acknowledging. The sheep hear his voice. He comes in, starts talking to his sheep, and the sheep are all excited, like, "Hey, I know that guy. That's my shepherd. He has the right to come in. He has the right to come get us. I love him. I love his voice. I acknowledge him." They say, this is great. We love our shepherd. So we see the acknowledging where it says the sheep hear his voice. I should probably just take my notes over there so I can stand over there. Imagine that. Third, we see, it's a big word, the appellation. Not the mountains, but the appellation is the naming of something. It is the very name of the sheep. I like big words. I like thesauruses. What's the plural? Anyways, it says, he calls his own sheep by name. Now, we understand naming animals, and we name our pets. The shepherd who spends all his lifetime with these sheep, day in, day out, you know he's going to name his sheep. He knows them each individually by name. And they probably had names like Blackie and Whitey and Old Gray Nose and Gimpy, because, you know, he had a bum leg, and whatever idiosyncrasy was used to name his sheep, he knew each and every one of them. In fact, before they go into the fold at night, he would make them pass under his rod. So he would stand there at the door, the porter would open the door as they're filing in for the night, and he would take his shepherd's crook and he would stop each sheep individually. And he would take that opportunity to check out each sheep, to literally check them out from top to bottom, front to back, make sure there weren't any wounds, no bruises, or anything that would cause further pain to the sheep. In fact, he had to, apparently there's so much lanolin in the sheep's wool, and they would produce so much of that oil that is used in all sorts of things of cosmetics and lipstick and cream and lotion and all sorts of things like that. They have so much of it that on their back end, it could actually plug them up, if you understand what I mean. It would mat the wool down, and the sheep could actually die because of that. So as you can imagine, it was a very messy, dirty process, but the shepherd had to keep them clean, had to keep them healthy. This was his role. So he would drop his rod, check over that sheep, talking to it, soothing it, encouraging it, because he knows this sheep. That is his own sheep. He talks to them, and then he would lift his rod once that one's checked out, and it would go in. He would then drop the next rod and check out each individual sheep. He knows them by name. And that's why in Ezekiel, I think it's chapter 22, it says that one day God will gather all of his people together and he will make us pass under his rod. That's the picture using there of checking each of us out, making sure that we're whole and healthy and provided for. It is the appellation. It is God comes to his sheep. The shepherd comes to his sheep and he calls them by name. And they follow him out. There was a really interesting story I read. It says, during the riots in Palestine in the middle 1930s, near the village Hafia, the entire village was condemned to collective punishment. The story didn't say what they'd done wrong, but they were all in trouble. So the punishment was to have all of their livestock, all their sheep and all their cattle sequestered. And that they had to then, each individual had to pay a set fee to get their livestock back. And there was one young lad who was an orphan who had 6 or 7 or 8 sheep. That was all that he had in the world. It was his very livelihood. And somehow he managed to scrape up the money to go purchase his sheep back. And he comes to the British sergeant in charge, and he pays the money for his sheep. And the sergeant kind of laughs. He says, well, you're welcome to the animals that you paid for, but ridiculed the idea that he could possibly pick out his little flock out of the hundreds of sheep, the hundreds of cattle in this pen. Little boy wasn't discouraged. He's like, no, I got him. Don't worry. I will pick out exactly mine. He took his little flute, played his little ditty on there, and he called his sheep. And his sheep heard his voice and came to him. And he gladly led them out. Because the sheep, he knew them by name, but also forth here, the sheep know the shepherd. The sheep hear his voice, calls him by name. Fourth is the accompanying. He leads them out. The shepherd comes back in the morning. He calls his sheep, and he takes them with him. And he leads them out to quiet pasture, still waters, and he takes care of them. I love this passage because, as we see in verse 9 and verse 11, who is our good shepherd? That's Jesus. Twice he says, I am the good shepherd. He knows us by name. He has the authority to come to us. He has the authority to lead us out. He knows us each individually by name. And when we hear his voice, we lovingly run to him. Isn't it wonderful to have a good shepherd today. Going down further, he says, my Father loves me because I laid down my life for my sheep. He loves us so much that as we will celebrate communion this Wednesday night and then Easter next Sunday morning, our good shepherd loves us so much that when he saw our need, when he saw our sin and wickedness that we could never hope to pay the penalty for, said, I will lay down my life for them. I will give everything that I have for my sheep. Isn't that so wonderful? That is our good shepherd. That is not some thief or robber that breaks in the other side who climbs over and steals and kills and destroys. Our good shepherd loves us so much that if it comes between his life and the sheep's life, he lays down his life. I think of David standing before Saul, about to go fight Goliath. And Saul's looking at this young boy and says, you can't go out. You are a boy. And Goliath was a soldier from his youth. This isn't going to work. And David turns to Saul and says, yeah. But you know, when I was tending my father's sheep, a lion came at me and a bear came at me. And they stole a lamb. And I went and hunted them down and I killed them. And he says, when I think it was the bear reared up at him, he caught him by the beard and slew that fierce animal. David knew that the shepherd protects the sheep at all costs because it is the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. If that bear had killed him but allowed that sheep to escape, David would have count his life gladly forfeit for the sake of his flock. That's our good shepherd. That's our God who loves us. That's our great King who gave his life for us and then gladly took it back up, being victorious over death and hell and the grave. And therefore, church, we do not fear. Because what can this world do to us? What can this world really do to us? Sure, they can make us suffer. They can give us pain and torment. But that is a short thing. And remember what Christ bore for us. He suffered the most excruciating death possible for us. So if he calls us to suffer, then we are gladly not repaying, but gladly rejoicing in the sufferings of Christ. And if the world comes to us and says, well, we're going to kill you, so? What's the harm in that? Yeah, sure. Paul said, I'm straightway between the two. To stay here is needful for you, Philippians, to minister to you and to give the gospel and to present the gospel to the world, and I want to do that. Yet at the same time, to depart is to be with Christ, and that is so much better. So really, what can the world do to us? Because we have our good shepherd protecting us. We have our good shepherd who bought us the victory. And it is that victory that we must go and tell the world of. That's what the Gideons do. That is what our missionaries that we see on the walls, that is what they are faithfully doing every day. It is our duty to reach Madison Heights, Amherst County, Lynchburg, and Central Virginia. Our missionaries have duties around the world. Our duty is here to tell the good news of our great shepherd. Let's bow for a prayer. Father, we're so thankful for our good, good shepherd, the one who has the right, the authority to enter the fold and to call us out, the one who, when he calls us, we hear and respond, the one who knows us each by name, and the one who leads us through this world, sharing the gospel with all those around us, for your glory. So, Father, bless us today. May we be renewed in our desire to reach the lost. May we be challenged to go to those who have never heard. May we be comforted in every sorrow and every bit of suffering that our great shepherd is right there beside us. Bless us and encourage us. Praise in Christ's name. Amen. Would you stand with me as we sing a hymn of invitation?
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Follow Christ this week. What he's called us to do. Share Christ this week. That is our duty. Marty, would you pray for us as we're dismissed?
Lord, thank you so much that you are our good shepherd. And thank you that you have given your life for your sheep. Thank you for eternal life in Christ. Thank you for all that we've enjoyed today in hearing your word, in hearing testimonies of your grace and your salvation. Thank you for the privilege we've had to bring our worship to you through song, through gifts, and even our presence here. I pray that you would dismiss us with your blessing. I pray that you'd watch over our church, guide us and bless us and unite us in Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.